listen. Heaven holds a place for those who pray.
Right, MWK, number 19, press car 1 if you prefer. Now the development cars, sometimes referred to as prototype cars, isn't strictly accurate. These cars were 99% there. They are pretty much identical to the production cars that would follow, but not quite, because of course they were development cars. The whole point really was to fine-tune, fettle, just work out some of the more minor details prior to actual mainline production. So let me show you around the car and show you a few of the subtle features that aren't quite the same as on your average Series 1. Now in 2018, at the JEC Roxall Abbey event, I was fortunate enough to meet Jonathan Haynes, who walked around the car, pointed out some of the features that are slightly different and that had been of interest to them at the time. Here, on the inlet manifold, you see there's this little nozzle on the end. During development, there was a whine, an inlet whine, through the manifold, and this nozzle cured it. And coincidentally, and happily, also added 2 horsepower to the car, which is no bad thing when you consider it's a 2.8 to begin with. Look at all that, tons and tons of space in that engine bay. The componentry, the cross members, slightly different arrangement to a standard Series 1. And the one of the problems with that being changing the oil filter is slightly more awkward, slightly more confined than on a production car. You tend to get grazed knuckles. I guess that's one of the reasons why they revised the layout a little. But the biggest difference is the bonnet pressing. So when Jaguar launched the XJ, the plan had been to have V-engine variants available from day one. And of course that didn't happen, the engines weren't available in time, and instead it was launched with 2.8 and 4.2 XK engines. Now, 2.8 engine fits under there, no problem. But the 4.2 with its slightly deeper block needed a deeper bulge in the middle of the bonnet. So it's very subtle, but if you compare MWK alongside a production Series 1, you'll find the central bonnet pressing ever so slightly deeper than on this car. Now let's have a look inside the car. William Lyons took a personal interest in the development cars. Remember, the XJ was his last car he was personally overseeing the development of. And Jonathan Haynes was explaining that part of the issue was always getting bespoke parts manufactured in time, keeping up to schedule. And some of them were awkward, difficult, having to come back and forth, get the manufacturers to provide something, tweak it, and so on. In particular, these window rubbers, the window frames, these bespoke components that were just being finalised. And here are a couple of R&D type features on the car. Here's a machined aluminium sill, which has been hacksawed, look. And under the seat squab, a bent tubular steel frame. Again, just showing early origins of the car. Looks more like something out of the 1950s under there. Okay, coming round now towards the back of the car, and this is what the purists will always pick me up on. So the glaring error are the pipes. These are cranked Series 3 pipes rather than the original Series 1. Now if you look at pictures of the original Series 1 cars with the straight pipes, they do look gorgeous, they do look better. There's no doubt the Series 3 pipes spoil the appearance. But the problem was that this fishtail on the car, the aerodynamics of the way the air would move past the car, it creates swirling vortices at the back of the car. And with the straight pipes, they would act to bring the exhaust fumes back in under the bonnet and on a long enough journey to get it through into the passenger compartment. And that was the reason for the cranking of the pipes. It just splayed the exhaust fumes just far enough out that the vortices wouldn't pull them into the car. So what do you do really? Carbon monoxide poisoning or aesthetics? But it's often commented on, it annoys the purists, and I'll be honest, I don't like these much either. So I think one of the remaining tweaks made to put MWK back to pretty much as it would have been would be to finalise the pipes, which I'll do. You might have noticed in some of the pictures, MWK appears with wing mirrors at some point, on the Castrol advert, for example, and then at other times without. But of course, as it was built, it was 3 of wing mirrors. I think it's much cleaner lines, and that was one of the first things I did to the car, was to get the wing mirrors taken off. Restore this lovely clean line of the wing. Another difference on very early cars, development cars, some of the early production cars, is the reflector location. They moved pretty early in production
down to beneath the rear lamp cluster, but on the earliest, up in the middle.
So interior, pretty much identical. The development cars, some of the early production cars, had these chrome bezels. Later production models had the plain black plastic.
This is the first time I'm here today. jump for joy. Come on without, come on within. You will not see nothing like the mighty Quinn. I like to go just like the rest. I like my sugar sweet, but jumping cues and making haste just ain't my cup of meat. Everyone's beneath the trees feeding pigeons on a limb, but when Quinn the Eskimo gets here, all the pigeons gonna run to him. Come on without, come on.
So MWK 28G is the 2.8 litre variant of the XK engine, and Jaguar produced the smaller capacity engine because the original XK was the 4.2, very good engine, it well tried and tested, and the reason was for the continental tax market. Jaguar were keen to boost sales on the continent, and tax rules there meant the smaller capacity engine attracting significantly less tax. But the revisions to the engine didn't do it any favours. The 4.2 XK engine was 220 brake horsepower, and the 2.8 just 140, so significantly less. And the improvement in fuel economy was really marginal, nothing to write home about. So the 2.8 always had something of a reputation as being slightly underpowered for the car, which is probably true, and there's no doubt it's not, doesn't suit the car quite as well as the 4.2. But nevertheless, if driven sensibly, well maintained, it's perfectly adequate. It's just not a very quick car. But early on, the 2.8s attracted a far worse reputation for reliability. And soon after cars introduced by the public, people who bought cars, they were being returned to Jaguar with holed pistons, so pretty catastrophic engine failure. And it turned out that the problem was carbonisation on the piston crowns. So people would take the cars for relatively short journeys, carbon would accumulate, and then on the occasion they went for a long run, in intense drive, maybe off to take families to the seaside, that would be the point at which the piston would hold. And it came as a surprise to the Jaguar engineers and to the test drivers, but of course the cars had been driven really quite intensively throughout testing. In fact, Jim Graham, who's the guy pictured in a lot of the shots through France and Spain, says just that, the engine was such a sweet engine because it was always driven hard. And other test drivers have said the same. In fact, I met a test driver at Vauxhall Abbey who could recall this particular engine from more than 50 years ago. So, not as good a match for the car as the 4.2, but not as bad as the reputation that it had either. And of course, Jaguar did fix the problems with the head, and that was settled. But the car never quite recovered from the reputation that it had gained. During testing, although MWK was pictured in a lot of the shots, I'm told it was never, or practically never, MWK that actually got driven. It was nearly always a 4.2 that was provided for the journalists. So Jaguar were clever. Now, it's a hot day today, and I've got the window up, and unfortunately there's no air conditioning, but just to keep sound down as we record. And actually, it's subdued sound in the car anyway. It's really a very refined, well-behaved car, very smooth. Suspension takes potholes, speed bumps, absolutely in its stride. And in fact, it's a conscious effort when you're mixing it with modern traffic to remember that this car is 52 years old, of course doesn't have all the driver aids that everyone else might be relying on to keep them out of trouble. But really testament to all the work of those Jaguar engineers, test drivers, over such a long period of time to make sure that even on the day of launch, the car was absolutely spot on.
So here amongst modern traffic, we're doing 60 miles an hour now, and still relatively subdued. As you get up to about 70, you begin to get some wind noise coming from the A-pillars. It's a very refined car. 70 now. But not quite the 4.2. So at 70 we're doing about 4,000 RPM. The car will do 85, 90, but it's not especially comfortable. And cruising speed is really around here, 70 miles an hour, quite comfortable. Of course, that's one thing about William Lahn's preference not to have headrests or seats encroaching above the glass line. Although there's no wind mirrors, the visibility, the glass area, is huge. It's very easy to keep aware of what's going on around you. This is such a sweet engine, this, as you can hear. And of course, it's now putting together all the history books and working out, because it's a 5-digit odometer. So to go through the history file and work out how many times it spun round. And this second engine, the engine Jaguar fitted in 69, has covered 260,000 miles of the original unit having done 20. So the car itself, 280,000 miles.
Gearbox is the original BorgWarner 3-speed, very robust, smooth. I had it refurbished a few years ago, but it doesn't give any trouble. Although, coupled with the 2.8 engine, it's obviously not a combination made for speed.
Now, one of the gremlins on these cars, no doubt, is electrics, and more specifically, Lucas Electric. Lucas, of course, Prince of Darkness. So the componentry is just not very reliable. And I learned fairly early on that when an electrical item on this car doesn't work, it's not broken. It's only broken if it doesn't work 3 times in a row. Then it's broken and you've got to do something about it. And the other maintenance issue that you really just need to learn to live with on these cars is perennial drops of oil. I was once taught that the only Jaguar that doesn't leak oil is a Jaguar that hasn't got any oil in it, and it's a good rule of thumb.